हूं आपके साथ विशाल कालरा और अब से कुछ मिनटों के भीतर चुनाव आयोग महाराष्ट्र और हरियाणा के विधानसभा चुनाव की तारीखों का ऐलान करने जा रहा है। ये सीधी तस्वीरें आप देख रहे हैं, अब से कुछ सेकंड्स में प्रेस कॉन्फ्रेंस शुरू हो जाएगी।
गुड आफ्टरनून, इस प्रेस वार्ता में आप सभी का स्वागत है।
ये लोग अशोक लवासा जी, सुशील चंद्रा जी, श्री अशोक लवासा जी, सुशील चंद्रा जी, ऑनरेबल डीसीज, all the friends from the press. I apologize that we had to again call you. देखो I said we apologize that we had to disturb your Saturday, but since most of you, as it is, work on Saturdays, many of you on Sundays also, we thought we can take that liberty. We did not even share with our personal staff that we told them that we'll meet each other on Monday. So after you people were informed, they were informed. Now I start my opening remarks. Democracy must in essence mean the art and science of mobilizing the entire physical, economic and spiritual resources of all the various sections of people in the service of common God of all. This was one of the quotes of, Mahatma Gandhi, whose 150th birth anniversary is being celebrated in India and many other parts of the world. Election Commission of India feels privileged and honored in playing its assigned role to renew democracy at national and state levels as mandated by the Constitution of India. We love the challenge of conducting new elections so that the nation emerges stronger from each one of them. Every new election leaves us with new insights, learnings, and lessons for the future. In that series, I now start about the elections to the state assemblies of Maharashtra and Haryana. The five-year term of legislatures of Haryana and Maharashtra, expiring on 2nd November and 9th November 2019. The Election Commission of India, in exercise of its authority and powers conferred under the Article 324 of the Constitution and Section 15 of Representation of Peoples Act 1951, is committed to hold free, fair, transparent, robust and ethical elections in these states before these dates. Haryana Legislative Assembly has strength of 90 seats, out of which 17 are reserved for SC and none for ST. Maharashtra Legislative Assembly has a strength of 288 seats, out of which 29 are reserved for SC and 25 for ST. Haryana has 1.82 crore registered voters, out of which 1.07 lakh are service voters. Maharashtra has 8.94 crore voters, out of which 1.16 lakh are service voters. A very detailed analysis of these figures has been given in the press release, which will be distributed immediately after the conference. In fact, we had a 19-page press release, but I thought reading 19 pages better if I read the main highlights in the next 3-4 pages, and then give you the dates for which you have come. In Haryana, 0.038 lakh ballot units, 0.25 lakh control units or VVMs and VVPATs, 0.27 lakh VPATs will be used. In Maharashtra, the corresponding figures are 1.8 lakh, 1.8 of BUs, 1.28 lakh CUs, and 1.39 lakh VPATs. In Haryana, the coverage of photo electoral roll and photo identity card is 100%. In Maharashtra, the coverage is 96.44 and 96.81% respectively. The Commission visited Mumbai on September 17th-18th to review the preparations for the Maharashtra elections. As is customary during the Commission meetings, we start with a dialogue with the political parties. We also have a detailed in-depth discussion with our CEO and the police nodal officer. Then we meet the district machinery, the field machinery, that is the collectors, SPs, DCPs, commissioners of police as case may be. After that we meet the central enforcement agencies and state enforcement agencies like income tax, state excise, GST, etc. Finally, we have a meeting interaction with Chief Secretary, Home Secretary, DGP, and all their senior colleagues. And after doing all this, whatever we have observed, seen, we share with the friends from the media. The same was followed this time also, and that's the standard way it's being done. In fact, prior to our visit, our senior most officer, Shri Umesh Sinha, he visited the state along with a team of his colleagues, and they also took an in-depth stock of the situation. One of the important things they brought to our notice was that slightly more than 5,000 polling booths are at the first floor or second floor level. This was taken up by them with the CEO and by the Commission also, with the CEO as well as the senior officials like Chief Secretary. And I am glad to report to you that they moved with absolute alacrity and have already brought those booths to the ground level. They had to spend more than, I think, 25 crores, which they sanctioned as a special grant. Election Commissioner Shri Ashok Lavasa ji visited Haryana on September 1 to take stock of the election preparedness in the state. Again, after that, a batch of senior officers led by Shri Sandeep Saxena, Senior Deputy Election Commissioner, visited the state to oversee the preparations. Normally, we have one DC in charge of each state, and the overall coordination is done by Umesh Sinha ji, and the overall management for the electoral rolls is done by, and ICT is done by Sandeep Saxena ji. EVM part is looked after by Dineep Sharma ji, DG, and then we have Oja ji and Shifali, you all know them. And in the part regarding the tax compliances is looked after by Dineep Sharma ji and their colleagues. Since it is less than 6 months that the 17th general elections to Lok Sabha were held, both the states we found were on a reasonably sound footing in terms of preparation. The ECI has instructed electoral offices in both the states to fill in the critical gaps to facilitate accessible voting by persons with disability and those senior citizens who might require special facilities. I already reported to you about the 5,000 polling stations. In addition, where there are old buildings in Maharashtra, especially in Mumbai, Pune, a whole lot of lifts that is also being physically cross-checked whether they are working or not, and what can be alternate arrangements in case there is a malfunctioning which cannot be removed in the short time available to them. Candidates have to fill the columns in nomination paper. Their nomination papers might be rejected if they leave any column blank and they do not fill them despite reminder. Similarly, candidates with criminal antecedents are required to publish information in the newspapers and television channels on three occasions during the campaign period. Here I would like to tell you that during the meeting with political parties, almost all the political parties had different interpretations of this, and they also said that within the expenditure limit, it's become pretty costly for us to spend this much money on just publishing these. But we told them that these are the directions of the Honorable Supreme Court. However, within the commission we are debating whether we can kind of find some solution in terms of either giving this responsibility, putting into the party expenditure, or directing the state governments and others to charge DIPR rates, etc. But that's premature. This is a combined feedback given to us from Haryana as well as from Maharashtra. But when we really examine it, I think on Monday, we'll kind of able to find a way forward. The ceiling for the elections and expenses for a candidate per constituency, both in Haryana and in Maharashtra, will be 28 lakhs. All candidates are required to file their accounts within 30 days of elections. Transaction of money through banking channels will be monitored and foolproof arrangements made to monitor suspicious banking transactions. In fact, when we had a meeting with the central enforcement agencies, we had also requested the chief of the state level bankers committee, normally an officer of the rank of GM in every state, to be present. And I must say that in Mumbai especially, we were very keen to know whether they are doing the monitoring of the cooperative banks also. We were assured that they are doing, but however, at this stage only I would like to announce that for Maharashtra, the commission has decided to send two special expenditure observers, and those two, the orders of which also will be issued today, in fact waiting to be signed, formally issued. One is Madhuji, an officer of 82 batch from the IRS, who retired as special DG investigation, etc. in income tax, and the other is Mr. Murali, who till recently was principal director investigation in Chennai and who is now retired. In fact, these are the two officers who had done all the operations in Vellore, which resulted in the rescinding of the elections. Now they are being sent to Maharashtra. In addition, income tax officials in any case go as expenditure observers to every constituency, but these two will be sent as special expenditure observers. Last time also we had sent special expenditure observers to Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Telangana, Andhra, depending on the feedback, the credible feedback which we had for the possibility of kind of crossing the expenditure limits, etc. The election campaigns often impose an environmental cost upon us. The commission had earlier asked the political parties in February to, this is basically an appeal, to reject plastic and use only environment friendly material in their election campaign. Ashok Lavasaji, having remained Secretary of Environment himself, had personally kind of guided that appeal. Again, we shall be renewing our appeal after formal announcement for the same. The ECI wishes to reassure the stakeholders about the functioning and quality of EVMs. On the poll day, a copy of Form 17C having details of the total votes polled, seals unique that is the unique numbers for the EVMs and VPATs used in the polling stations shall be provided to the polling agents of candidates. Similarly, the polled EVMs and New pads will be sealed in respective cases and preserved in a strong room under double lock system. These strong rooms will be guided 24/7 in multi-layered security cover with CCTV facilities. Candidates are free to camp at a convenient distance from the strong rooms, if they so desire, without disturbing the government security arrangements. EVM votes of 5 randomly selected polling stations of every assembly segment will be matched with VPAT slips, as was done during Lok Sabha, under the directions of the Honorable Supreme Court. Adequate central armed police will be deployed for security during the electoral process. And Umesh Sinhaji and his colleagues, they had a series of meetings with the MHA officials, and all the demand for the CPFs is always much on the higher side, but still they were able to reach at a reasonable figure. And special security arrangements will be in place for LWV affected areas, for example, Gadchiroli and Gondia in Maharashtra, like that. Commission has, during our review with the officers, we again buttressed the need for speedier execution of non-billable warrants and very speedy disposal of pending cases of the electoral offences from last elections. But by and large, the situation was satisfactory. They were also asked to ensure 100% deposition of arms unless exempted under specific category, which orders will also come in force after this press conference. As we speak, they are already coming in force. Adequate CCTV coverage and webcasting in polling stations in sensitive areas will be ensured. All the police checkposts across the state will be under 24/7 webcasting videography for the entire period of elections. General and police observers will be deployed after the announcement of elections by the commission in the two states to monitor all the activities and ensure compliance of the directions of ECI. And by the way, the first training or orientation or interaction with the general observers is already scheduled on Monday, the day many of you thought that we'll be announcing the election schedule, but we have already slotted interaction with the observers, one batch of observers. Model code of conduct is a real tribute to the Indian democracy, in the sense that it's basically a product of a broad consensus of the ECI with political parties over a period of time. And now we have several IT applications to kind of track the observance of model code of conduct, like Suvidha, CVGIL apps, which have time stamping facility to ensure transparency. The influence of media has increased manifold in the lives of citizens, as it should be in any vital and vibrant democracy. The Commission has always considered media as its invaluable ally in the elections. Even during Lok Sabha elections, I think there were weekly or 10 days briefing by our officers with the members of the media, and the suggestions given by them were taken with earnestness and seriousness. Social media is another kind of phenomena whose footprints have increased exponentially. Prior to the elections of Lok Sabha, all the commission had engaged with a very detailed dialogue with the various entities in the social media, and they had themselves come up with a voluntary code of ethics. They gave it to the commission before the elections started, and I think, bearing rare exceptions, we did not have many cases in which a communal riot was started or any such thing happened due to social media. Otherwise, that is a different thing. They criticize X, Y, Z. Somebody does it politely, somebody does it virulently. That's different from kind of using social media to create problems in the electoral process. The commission has directed that there should be assured minimum facilities at all polling stations, including especially for the persons with disability, as I said, and senior citizens who might require special assistance. The commission has also directed that at least one all-woman polling station shall be set up in each assembly segment of a parliamentary constituency in the state. Before concluding, I would like to reiterate that the commission is totally committed to maintain purity of the elections and to deliver free, fair, transparent, inclusive, accessible and ethical elections in the country. We seek the cooperation of all the stakeholders, including all of you friends sitting here, in this process. We also have a 64 by-elections in various states. A separate schedule will be issued by press release about 1 hour after this press conference and shall be available on the website of ECA. But the schedule I read out just now, we only had some problems, for example, in Andhra, in two cases there is EP, and Karnataka, I'm sorry, two cases there is EP. In West Bengal, the local government has written to us that the by-elections should not be held during the Durga Puja, because practically for almost a fortnight, entire West Bengal is shut celebrating the Puja, and we have actually acceded to that request. In Uttarakhand, at the moment, panchayat elections are going on, so those dates have also been titrated according to that. Everywhere we went, the political parties, especially in Maharashtra, they were very emphatic that the election should be finished at least before Dhanteras. And by the way, if I take out the chart of holidays during September and October, it must be a very onerous exercise done by our officers to fix up and go around the holidays. This is the kind of chart of holidays in September, October, various holidays, various sizes. If anybody is interested, I can share it. Notwithstanding that, while paying compliment to them, and despite the issues of availability of central forces, the schedule is as follows. Issue of notification, 27. Schedule for Maharashtra and the entire press conferences for Maharashtra and Haryana. Sorry?
Both the states.
Both the states. 27 November. October. September. Last date of nominations, 4th October. Issue schedule for Maharashtra and Haryana General Assembly elections is as follows. The notification for both the states shall be issued on 27 September. Last date of nominations is 4th October. Scrutiny of nominations is 5th October. Last date of withdrawal of candidature is 7th October. Date of poll, I repeat, date of poll for both the states is 21st October.
21st?
Yes, 21st. Counting is 24th.
So counting?
24th. Single phase. That's right. Sorry? हिंदी में नोटिफिकेशन जो है वो 27/9 को जारी होगी. नॉमिनेशन जो है उसका आखिरी जो अंतिम तिथि है वो 4 अक्टूबर है. जो नॉमिनेशन का स्क्रूटनी करते हैं यानी कि उसका एनालिसिस करते हैं अंडर द लॉ वो 5 अक्टूबर तक है. 5 अक्टूबर को है. अगर किसी कैंडिडेट ने विड्रॉ करना हो तो लास्ट डेट 7/10 है. जो पोलिंग है यानी कि जो वोटिंग है वो 21 अक्टूबर को है. जो काउंटिंग ऑफ वोट्स है वो 24 को है दोनों स्टेट्स में. और सारा प्रोसेस 27/10 तक कंप्लीट हो जाएगा क्योंकि जो टर्म ऑफ द हाउसेज हैं इसकी हरियाणा की 2 नवंबर और महाराष्ट्र की 9 नवंबर. तो 2 नवंबर चूंकि हरियाणा की है तो एवरीथिंग गोज बैकवर्ड फ्रॉम देयर इज काउंटेड बैकवर्ड फ्रॉम देयर. तो सारा प्रोसेस 27 तक पूरा हो जाएगा. काउंटिंग 24. In any case, this is going to be put on the website now. Your schedule of by-elections, number one, notification, 23 September. Issue of notification, 23rd September. 23rd. By-elections. Last, I have read English first, in Hindi. फिर दोनों भाषा में पढ़ दूंगा. सभी स्टेट्स इंक्लूडेड हैं एक्सेप्ट सॉरी आई रीड आउट द स्टेट्स. आप सुन आपने पहले शेड्यूल सुनना है या नंबर सुनने हैं? अरुणाचल 1, असम 4, पहले मैं अभी असेंबलीज के पढ़ रहा हूं. अरुणाचल 1, असेंबली असम 4 यानी 4, बिहार 5 यानी 5, छत्तीसगढ़ 1 यानी 1, गुजरात 4 यानी 4, हिमाचल प्रदेश 2, कर्नाटका 15, केरला 5, मध्य प्रदेश 1, मेघालय 1, उड़ीसा 1, पुडुचेरी 1, पंजाब 4.
चलिए इस वक्त की बड़ी खबर आपको बता दें, 21 अक्टूबर को है वोटिंग. 2 राज्यों की तारीखों का ऐलान कर दिया गया है. हरियाणा और महाराष्ट्र विधानसभा चुनाव की तारीखों का ऐलान इस प्रेस कॉन्फ्रेंस के जरिए. हरियाणा और महाराष्ट्र के वोटर्स को वोटिंग के लिए जाना है, अपने मताधिकार का इस्तेमाल करना है. 21 अक्टूबर को होगी वोटिंग और 24 अक्टूबर को यह साफ हो जाएगा कि हरियाणा और महाराष्ट्र के वोटर्स ने